Hello, welcome. Thank you so much for showing up at the very first event that we are having here at New York Live Arts. And I, first of all, I want to thank Bill T. Is Bill T. here?
I'm here.
Yay! Thank you so much, Bill, for giving me this chance to invite some of my favorite people in the world to do some things. We decided to just, when we were talking about what we'd like to do, we landed on something having to do with sky. So I got to invite one of my favorite writers and filmmakers who's going to kind of change your worldview in the next 45 minutes. And I'm not going to say too much more, except that we talked a little bit about about various ways to discover things, and one of the things he'll be talking about is how technology creates science, which I find like kind of a mind-blowing idea. And also, I find that many of the ways that artists and scientists are making things have a lot more to do with each other than I had originally thought, particularly because artists and scientists make things first and then kind of go, what is this? And then they have a very similar question. That's the next question is, when is it finished? So in order to know when it's finished, you have to know what you're making. So this is one of the things that the amazing author and filmmaker and Tim Ferris is going to be speaking. Please welcome Timothy Ferris.
Thank you so much, Laurie. Pleasure to be here. For that kind introduction. I'm going to be talking about belief. And to start, I'd like to define what I mean, since we use the word in many ways. I don't mean belief as in the sense of I believe the star, the Carl star in the morning, even though it's cold outside, or I believe I'll have another drink. Belief is defined in this talk as feeling certain without factual proof that something is true. And the operative term there is proof. All belief systems accumulate facts which are thought to support the belief. But the question is there factual proof? If not, then you're talking about a belief. When you do have factual proof, you're talking about knowledge, comprehending with factual proof that something probably is true. Probably is the closest you can ever get. And I'll come back to why that is in a few minutes. So if you are presented with a proposition that is absolutely pure truth, no probability whatever, you're in the realm of belief. When you have factual proof and you're only probably sure it's correct, you're in the realm of knowledge. People move between these realms all the time. For instance, there are a number of practitioners of meditation and mindfulness who may have come into Buddhism as a belief system, but then found that these practices are useful. Many of these practices now rest on the basis of factual proof as having efficacy. So in that case, you would have gone from a belief system to a knowledge system in that one regard. I'm going to talk today about the contrast between belief systems and non-belief systems. Here are two of the major ones. Religion, of course, 80% of humanity declares that they have religious belief. Almost all religions posit at least two things, the existence of a deity and the existence of life after death. More recently in history, dating back to about the 17th century, we've seen the rise of secular belief systems called ideologies. The term was coined by an associate of Napoleon Bonaparte, who warned that ideologies would create what he called bloodthirsty men. Seems like an odd statement coming from Napoleon, but in fact turned out to be accurate. Ideology killed upwards of 30 million civilians, exclusive of warfare, 30, 40 million people under the control of their own governments in the 20th century alone. So technically, ideology is the most dangerous belief system ever created. And its strength comes, the ideology part has to do with the fact that you've created a system that you think, that you believe, will make the world better, and you believe in it, and you have fellow believers. So it has an intellectual side to it, but really it's an expression of the oldest political opinion of all, that my tribe's good, your tribe's evil. Salvation will arrive once my tribe prevails. That's where you get the emotional strength of ideology. Ideology has risen as traditional religious belief systems have declined. So for instance, in England and in France, where there used to be official state religions, but where religious belief has fallen off to the point that only about one in three Brits any longer claims to have a religious faith, and only one in four French do. At the same time, there's been a rise in ideological thinking, which tends to strengthen the idea that ideology is a kind of secular religion. Now, I'd like to, while we're talking about politics, make a couple of points about the difference between reality-based and ideologically-based politics. This is a diagram of a fairly normal political spectrum, as you would see in many countries, really around the world. Here's the traditional line. For some reason, people are used to thinking of politics as being arrayed along a single spectrum. That was never the case. Left, right, and it produces a lot of confusion. But here is that spectrum. On the left, you have progressives who tend to focus on what could be made better in society and have ideas of how to improve those society and fix those problems. And over here, you have conservatives who are more concerned to preserve things that have been proven by experience to work, or at least work well by their own estimation. My point about these two positions and the others I'm going to talk about is that these are legitimate, practical ways of looking at the political world. They're not belief systems at all. You have different interests if you're working in a factory at a low wage or if you own the factory, and the political dynamics reflect that. This other axis doesn't get talked about as much, but it's equally important. Over here, this is a boxing ring, by the way, it seems appropriate. Down here is authoritarian political system. This is the oldest way of governing people. It simply consists of a system in which the person who can get power does. I mean, it doesn't matter how you get it. It can be violent, be through connivance. You get power and you hold on to it, and you don't worry about how legitimate it may or may not be. It's an authoritarian government. And what you do down here is that you minimize the rights of the people in your society. The opposite of that is liberalism, liberal systems in which you maximize people's freedom. I want to be clear about this point because there's been a lot of confusion, mainly because American progressives some years ago, and now European progressives too, have started calling themselves liberal. Now they've started moving away from that, but it caused confusion. Liberalism has nothing to do with the left or the right. It's an original political philosophy, first enunciated best by John Locke, set forth by others. It is the philosophy that is declared in the American Declaration of Independence, which followed John Locke so closely that Thomas Jefferson later found it necessary to say, I wrote Declaration of Independence alone in a rooming house. I didn't even have any books of Mr. Locke with me. I didn't know I was copying anything. It's the founding principle of this country and many other what are called liberal democracies. And the liberalism was invented in emulation of science. Science is an experimental system, and the idea of liberalism was experimental in at least two ways. First, it was, of course, a great experiment to try any system in which you put rights and power in the hands of ordinary people. It was just the opposite of the oldest political tradition in the world, so it took some doing. But it's also inherently experimental in that the idea of liberal democracy is that you have elections which are constantly new experiments. So you don't like the way things are going, you throw some people out, bring people, other new people in. Liberalism is essentially based on those notions. First, that people should be maximally free. That's the Bill of Rights. Second, that they're equal before the law. And third, that they get to elect their government rather than having the government tell them how everything's going to go. And John Locke added to that, wrote a whole book about it, that if you're going to expect the electorate to do this, they should at least be literate, which most people weren't. And so the state should support free universal public education. So we have liberal democracies. About 40% of humans in the world now live in liberal democracies. The rest would like to, according to every poll ever made. That's one reason why there's been such an increase in the amount of education in the world. So you have sort of, obviously there are tensions between being a liberal state and authoritarian state, between being progressive and conservative, and a lot of interesting things happen. For instance, many people start out as students locked into a view here or here might be the view that they grew up with at home. And then as they learn more about the world, they begin to see the advantages of freedom, letting people make up their own minds, so they'll wander up here a bit. If you only look at this part, it'll look as if they've moved to the center. And that's a lot of what you hear in political campaigns, is that you capture the center. In every liberal democracy, you win national office by capturing the center. It's the only way elections have been won. But really, what you're saying is that the center is liberal. Americans are a liberal people by this definition. I remember back where I live in San Francisco, when the first gay marriages were performed by then Mayor Gavin Newsom, the courts very quickly shut them down. And a young lady who was there demonstrating on behalf of gay marriage was interviewed by someone who said, well, it's a setback for you. And she said, it doesn't matter, because Americans now understand that this is a civil rights issue. And in the history of the United States, no civil rights issue has ever failed. And we have now, 37 states in which gay marriage is legal? So she was right. Liberalism is the real philosophy of this country and many, many others. Now, if instead we change this to a system of beliefs, ideologies, then it looks like this. You have authoritarianism, which is not much of a philosophy, but simply means that in power-based countries like, say, North Korea, you either have to believe that the great leader is a wonderful genius and the greatest golfer on earth and the author of 50 operas and so forth, as was the case with the previous Mr. Kim, or you have to pretend that you do. Over on the left, you have various ideological bubbles, and the same thing on the right. And what happens if you live in an ideological bubble is everything else tends to look like a bubble to you. So there's your ideology, which is good, and then there's everybody else's ideology, which is more or less evil. The thicker the walls of this bubble, the more distorted and dimmer your view of the wider world. That's the problem with belief systems. Any day, any hour of the night or day on the internet, you can see these folks hurling these charges back and forth at each other, calling each other names, getting offended. That's because they have subscribed to ideologies. And even up here, liberally, there is an ideology called libertarianism. It mostly consists of belief that any reduction in the power of government will make things better. Incidentally, there is something to this. One of the problems the liberal democracies have is that in all of them, the amount of money amount of resources taken up by the state increases decade after decade as a share of the total economy. That can't go on forever, or the state will end up running everything just because by virtue of having grown so much. So there is a case for making government smaller, certainly national government, but this libertarianism is essentially a faith that's always the best approach. Now, ideology leads to a number of beliefs that you see a lot on the internet. I just picked these up in the last couple of weeks. You've all seen them, and I would be surprised if some of the folks here in this audience didn't believe at least some of these statements. However, they are all factually groundless. I mean, a lot of arguments take place over this stuff. Let me quickly go through them at the risk of offending everybody. Scientists do not have any trouble agreeing about global warming. Global warming has been understood for a long time. Science goes back more than a century. The idea that there's some great controversy is almost entirely a result of political propaganda. The U.S. spends more on defense than on education. That's you hear that one all the time. It's almost always false, except at the time of full warfare. Last year, for instance, we spent close to $500 billion on education, a little over $400 billion on defense. Fracking contaminates drinking water. That's a very popular one. I reinforced recently in The Simpsons, in which the phrase "flames shooting out of your faucet" appeared three times in the same episode. However, fracking shouldn't contaminate drinking water, and I'm unaware of a single adjudicated case where it has yet done so. And if you saw those documentaries with the flames shooting out, they certainly do, but they've been doing that for 80 years. That has nothing to do with fracking. Republican administrations deliver higher corporate profits. My Republican friends are always astonished to learn that this is not true. For 90 some odd years now, Democratic administrations have delivered higher corporate profits, higher rates of GDP growth, and better stock market returns than Republicans have. That's true any way you normalize it. GMOs are unsafe to eat, believed by 57% of Americans, factually groundless. And finally, vaccinations cause autism, equally groundless. Why are so many people persuaded by invalid arguments like this? It's because they fit into an ideological world picture that they happen to share. Half of these are more or less right-wing ideologies, the other half are more or less left-wing ideologies. It's rather peculiar to see, because I've seen the spectacle of people who have never set foot on a farm suddenly emotional to the point of anger over some issue involving agriculture for purely ideological reason. It has no factual basis at all. So that's a lot of what we see in political dialogue these days. Why is it considered impolite to discuss religion and politics at a dinner party? The obvious reason is that people get angry. It's a quick, it's an easy path to people raising their voices and calling one another names. Why? I think the reason is that most of us inherited our religious beliefs, if any, or our lack of religious beliefs, and our political opinions growing up pretty much from our parents. Most Democrats are the children of Democrats. Most Republicans are children of Republicans. So the tendency is to grow up with that old opinion, my tribe's good, your tribe's evil, without ever stopping to examine it. It's a rare person who at some point, maybe in college, says, well, let me look back at the very foundations of all these belief systems, see if mom and dad knew what they were talking about. People don't do that generally. So you have a combination of a deep felt belief that you associate with your love for your parents, combined with the insecurity that comes of knowing on some level that you don't really understand what it's based on. that will make people furious. And that's why it's not a good idea to bring it up in social situations. I must say that the longer I've been around, I've been alive quite a while now, the more I have seen the value of completely empty small talk in many circumstances. So we have belief systems, starting with religion, which is ancient and still very popular, as I say, 80% of the world, and including ideology, which is relatively recent, has been rising in popularity for some time. And then there are these new systems, which are called empirical, and all empirical means is based on experiment. This is something about science that hasn't always been widely appreciated. Science is not a philosophy. You don't do science by having good ideas. It can help, just as it can help in carpentry or any number of other things. You do science by conducting experiments, and so these systems are called empirical or experimental systems. You can call them fact-based, which is kind of, you know, apt to compare facts to belief, but everybody accumulates facts one way or another. The key is, do you experiment? And you certainly do in science. And you do in liberal democracy, as we've been describing. Every election is an experiment. And by the way, the opponents of empirical systems, believers in ideology and such, are the first to attack this and to tell you that voting doesn't matter and it's all fixed up game and so forth. Then they also, the same folks will tell you that words don't mean anything, in which case we're all wasting our time here because it wouldn't matter what words any of us uttered. A couple of observations about the difference between these systems. Belief systems divide the world, they bifurcate the world. They do this in at least two ways. The first one is pretty obvious. There's not just one religion on earth, or not just one ideology. So when you subscribe to a belief system, you are excluding all the others. That's pretty obvious. It is a little weird. I mean, it was a lot, when humans didn't know much about the world, and everyone you met was of the same religion you were born into, it was a little easier to understand your religion than once you came to realize that there are hundreds of others. But somehow you say, okay, well, ours is the true belief and the others are not, somehow. However, a belief system also divides the world in a deeper way, and that is you have an imaginary world created out of belief. Remember, it has to be imaginary because it's not based on factual proof. And then you have the factual world that you live in every day. And every believer has to deal with this, and many methods have been worked out to do it. But the fact is, nevertheless, you have divided the universe. And this was fine when, for thousands and thousands of years, we didn't know enough about the universe to know whether the divisions were appropriate. After all, you could live in a world that had, might be 100 different systems of physics operating, and we only live in one. So get along with bifurcating the world. That's getting a little harder to do, as I'll explain. Belief systems always answer all questions. They are what are known logically as closed systems. Every belief system ultimately refers back to some text or set of texts, some logical structure to which everything must answer. And all disputation has to do with whether X fits properly or how it fits into the belief system. So belief systems are inherently closed. And they like to claim otherwise, but I see no way around it. Empirical systems quite different in this sense. First, they unify the world. This didn't have to be the case. It's a discovery, it's not an assertion. When Edwin Hubble discovered that the universe was divided into galaxies, so we live in a Milky Way galaxy, about 400 billion stars, and there are a few little satellite galaxies, and then there's about 2 million light years over to the next big galaxy. Hubble was was concerned that there might be different laws of physics in each of these systems, and he called, his term for galaxies was island universes. He was very relieved when spectra of light could be obtained from these other galaxies, and it was shown that they were made of the same elements and they operated the same way as physics does here on Earth. So science discovered that the entire universe is one system, that all life on Earth is the same form of life, that we're not just closely related to animals, we are animals, and a whole number of other things, that the mind is not some entity that floats up above the material world, it's a manifestation of the material. So the unity of the world is a scientific discovery, although it was often postulated by philosophers and mystics before. And empirical systems never answer all questions. They're inherently open. Science will never end, and I'll show you why momentarily. Another difference between facts and beliefs is that facts are what is known as invariant through transitions. This, if you're mathematically inclined, you realize this is a definition of symmetry. All the laws of physics are statements of symmetry. And what you usually think of in terms of geometry. So here's a sphere. A sphere is Plato's favorite form because it is a sphere no matter how you look at it. So it is invariant through transformations in space. You can walk around it or fly over it, it's still a sphere. And because space and time are inherently linked, it's also like every other object that exists, it's invariant across time. So that it'll stay sitting on this lake at least for a minute or so. But it's invariant. Beliefs are not. A fact is what defines a fact is that everyone can agree that it's a fact. You can travel anywhere, you can go to a scientific conference on the other side of the world, and everyone still agrees that about what the facts are. Those who don't like science and would assert belief systems will also attack this claim. They'll say that, facts are slippery things. Nobody knows what facts are, but that's not the case. Beliefs are not. There's a great attempt to make beliefs seem as if they were invariant. A lot of work by theologians has been done on that. But if you just think about ideology, for instance, if you take a rock-ribbed American conservative serving, let's say, in Congress, the Republican Party, and send him out to dinner with a rock-ribbed conservative doula from Iran, they're probably not going to have a whole lot that they agree about, even though they're both conservatives. So there are a lot of opinion systems that don't translate the way facts do. There is such a thing as a scientific method. Here it is. You have an idea, you design and conduct an experiment that will test this idea, and then you affirm, revise, or deny the idea based on the result of the experiment. And this wheel keeps turning. It's been turning for about 400 years now. Let me show you an example of how it works. 1928, Paul Dirac wrote an equation for the describing the electron, or what you could call the electromagnetic field. Absolutely beautiful piece of insight, and correctly predicts the outcome of all sorts of interactions. You could call it the cornerstone of the electronics industry. But it had a problem, in that the equations demanded that there had to be a particle that was just like an electron but opposite it in charge, what we would call antimatter. This was the first prediction of an antimatter particle. Dirac, to his credit, didn't try to fix the equations. He just published it saying, I don't understand. These things look like holes in space or something, and they don't seem to exist, but that's what the theory says. Carl Anderson, at a particle detection experiment in 1932, then discovered antimatter just a few years later without even knowing about this theory. So thus the Dirac equation was affirmed even in its strangest manifestation, the discovery of antimatter. Belief, very different. You have an idea, you never experiment, and one looks very, it is very hard to find anything in the history of any belief system in which experiments were conducted to determine whether any, whether the beliefs might be false. And you always affirm the belief. So we have these two different systems, empirical and belief systems. Can they coexist? Well, evidently, yes. That's been happening for the centuries since the first empirical systems rose to prominence, the ones we've been talking about. It's happening now. But it is interesting that many of today's global conflicts are between authoritarian belief systems and liberal empirical systems, liberal democracies. So they can exist, but they can't very well be said to be existing in perfect harmony. Should they coexist? Here, you get very different answers from the two sides. Empirical systems say yes. In other words, liberal democracy's position is that everyone should believe or not believe what as they see fit. So it's fine with the liberal system if people have beliefs, different beliefs, that's all great. The belief systems, not so much. Belief systems typically, let's talk about religions, have been liberal and accepting when the government or the people have obliged them to be. Their history when they've had the power to enforce their belief has not been particularly exemplary. In Saudi Arabia, for instance, where the entire public education system was turned over to the Wahhabists a long time ago, the result was not a set of schools that taught a rainbow of different values, but rather the teaching of all students in the contents of one single book. This illustration, by the way, is voters queuing up in Soweto. The next time Russell Brand or someone tells you not to vote, remind me this photo. Knowledge banishes belief. I don't know why this point isn't made more often or more clearly. If you're lost in the woods and you don't have a map, you have no idea how to save yourself, you're frightened, you might well fall back on your belief system. You might pray, perfectly human thing to do. If you have a map in your pocket or your phone tells you where you are and you can look and say, oh, the trail has just 3/4 mile over there, I'll be home for dinner, then you don't need your belief system. Because you've got knowledge. This is bad news for some belief systems because the amount of human knowledge is growing exponentially. This has never happened before in human history. The growth rate in human knowledge used to be comparable to the economic growth rate, which was below 0.1% per year. I chose this thing because, as an example, this was the number of books added annually to the British Library. It ends in 1960, so if we were to bring it up to the present, I'd have to have like an Al Gore cherry picker over here on the right and goes up, on up through the ceiling. We're using books here because a book roughly can be taken to represent some body of knowledge. It's hard to measure exactly what knowledge is. You know, the amount of data in the world is doubling now, something like every 2 years or 2 months. Data isn't the same thing as knowledge exactly. But real knowledge has a doubling time that's gone over human history from centuries to generations to probably something like a decade now. So we're in the middle of this extraordinary growth in knowledge. What the effect of that will be on belief, I don't know, because I don't know whether people generally feel a need to believe, you know, or whether belief will tend to retreat before front of the on-rising tide of more knowledge. Now these science and democracy are new, but they've managed to accomplish a few things, and here are some of them. In the past 2 centuries, the life expectancy, median life expectancy of all humans on Earth has more than doubled. The global per capita income has gone up by a factor of more than 10. We are in the midst of, this is the largest anti-poverty movement in the history of the world, and it outranks all the prior efforts to reduce poverty combined. World literacy and education levels have soared. There are a lot of amazing numbers in here, which I would urge you to look up if you're interested in the question of global learning. Here in the United States, for instance, over 40% of college-age men and women are now in college. For the rest of the world, aside from sub-Saharan Africa, which has problems of its own, for the rest of the world, with that exception, almost one in three college-age men and women are in college. This is an absolutely unprecedented and really unexpected educational achievement. There was no optimist in the history of the world writing about some wonderful future whoever predicted anything like these educational levels, these kinds of life expectancy, or this kind of an increase in available resources. Racial, gender, and ethnic inequalities have been reduced worldwide. That's largely the result of scientific research. Before science came along, it was possible for a racist, for instance, to just be racist because not enough was understood to say what can be said today, which is that we know, as a matter of fact, that there's no basis for these sorts of prejudices, and that's been corrosive to them. They haven't vanished. There's nothing perfect here. There's nothing perfect in the universe. But these are big changes in the world. And as we say, the sum of human knowledge has increased exponentially. So the non-belief-based systems have done those things, and they have also led to discoveries which nobody had anticipated. There is no mystic, no priest, no spiritualist in the history of the world that ever came up with any of these, even though I still get letters from folks who say, well, if you'll just read this passage of the Quran while standing on one foot and so forth, you'll see that it demonstrates what Einstein said. These include answers to ancient questions that people always wondered about. How does life evolve? We now know the answer to that. And it's surprising that it isn't is more widely taught than it is. There's been a lot of effort in the elementary schools and high schools to teach it. And yet a recent study showed that even many college seniors don't understand biological evolution. It is a subtle, weird, non-intuitive process that got us all here. And in a sense, the people who oppose evolution have a better idea of how shocking it is than do those who blandly accept it. I urge the study of biological evolution because that's the way everything in the universe works. I'll show you what I mean about that in just a second, but it happens to be the way we discovered the basic mechanisms of nature. People always wondered where the Earth came from. Now we know. Specifically, the Earth was formed in the spiral arm of this galaxy a little under four and a half billion years ago as part of these star forming events that happen in the arm of the galaxy. You create thousands of stars at once out of clouds of dust and gas. They have a whole spectrum from giant stars down to modest ones. The giant stars burn much faster than the little ones. Counterintuitively, the burn rate goes up by the cube of the mass. So while those stars are still there, the big ones start exploding. They create heavy elements like gold. If you're wearing any gold, that's where it came from. Explosion of the star near the sun 4.5 billion years ago. All this material got incorporated into the solar system. The solar system has evolved since. Everybody always used to wonder about this. Now we know. How do stars shine? Discovered about 1930, the process of nuclear fusion. Cause of disease, public health, which has had so much to do with that increase in the human life expectancy. And how economies work, which might seem relatively mundane, but which has been instrumental in poverty reduction and reductions in global hunger. Now, I'm going to quickly throw in a... getting late here. Going to quickly throw in a slide that has nothing to do with this talk, but it's sort of the base of another talk. But just to acquaint you with the idea, for many years, like others interested in this subject, I've been looking into the question of why did science get discovered when and where it did. We've had all sorts of books explaining this, from guns and germs to even a religious philosopher who said that Christianity created science. I asked him once, well, why did it take so long? And I've come to, this is just my opinion now, but I've come to feel that science, and therefore liberal democracy, was inspired by science. Science inspired the Enlightenment and so forth. But the question is, where did science come from? The answer is technology. This is just a shot taken on my desk. This is a Neanderthal hand axe, pretty good axe, 50,000 years old. Excellent axe. You pick it up, you immediately know how to use it. And behind it, a computer. The computer's at an earlier stage of development than the axe, but has more potential. Science came about when technology reached the point that for reasonable investment, such as a private person might make, you could purchase equipment with which to conduct experiments that would actually answer questions. That's when the enterprise took off. So I'm just going to conclude by showing you a little bit of vision of what the world now looks like from the standpoint of what has been accomplished by these empirical, fact-based systems. And this is just a model for looking at the world. You might find it useful. If you don't use it, but I've found it handy. And in this model, we think of the world as essentially based on three elements, or three stages. The lowest level is chaos. The universe appears on good evidence to have begun or have emerged from a set of chaotic quantum fields. And quantum fields are what everything's made of. Everything in this room and everything else in the universe is all quantum fields. What we call particles are manifestations of the way fields interact with one another. So the universe has always been quantum fields. But back at the beginning, they were chaotic. And there's a precise mathematical definition of chaos. It means if you take a scoop of something, you can't describe it in an equation that's any shorter than the content of the scoop itself. So it's kind of the last word on itself. There's no structure of chaos. But, interestingly, chaos always has to create little areas that are less chaotic. If you think about it, you have no choice. You can't be chaotic without accidentally making some areas that are slightly more ordered. I like to call those structures. You can think of them as emerging, kind of coming up out of the chaos and then subsiding back. Well, and you can see this in the vacuum today. If you just look at a vacuum, you'll see quantum fields constantly appearing and disappearing back into the vacuum. It's the way nature works. Occasionally, by chance, you'll get a structure this way that will not subside back because, by chance, it has some sort of ratchet that tends to make it persist a bit. And you then have a structure that persists for some significant period of time. What you call significant is just a matter of the observer, how much time and space you want to sample. In the case of our universe, it's been 13 billion years so far. The universe has a structure, has lasted that long, and probably has another 20 to 100 billion years left in it. Once that happens, once you have a structure that persists, you get selection, because that's now an environment, and some random fields coming through that environment will be better suited for it than others. That's why I was talking earlier about the evolution of life. You understand the evolution of life, you understand how nature works. And at the top, you have information, which is the only way we know about these earlier systems. So in this little picture, I'll quickly give you, this is just a technical summary, but the universe arises from chaos. Chaos necessarily creates structures sooner or later. Structures which persist constitute environments where selection occurs. And all environments cause selection. The experience world consists of quantum fields interacting to produce information. Information, this is slightly conjectural, but it appears information cannot be destroyed. There's not a mathematical proof of this, but it is very difficult to envision a scenario in which information could be destroyed. So every bit of information created exists forever, although not locally. All concepts are derived from information, which is why I like to think of it that way. So we're left with a picture that looks like this German romantic painting. If you think of the clouds as being chaos, and you have these structures that have emerged from out of chaos, and one of them is a human being, the only animal apparently so far in the history of this planet with a mind capable of what we call language, which is to say abstraction, the ability to manipulate abstractions and create an accurate result. In other words, to do science. So you look back, garnering information from the world that brought you yourself to this point. I'm going to end with just a couple of interesting little scientific facts that bear on this. First, the universe is open in space and time. That is, the universe is expanding and appears likely to continue expanding indefinitely. And that means that no matter how smart you are, the most advanced civilization out there, the most gleaming tools, doubtless far beyond us, but all they can do is keep exploring the universe. You can't ever get to the end of it. Everyone's in the same situation. It always stretches out in all directions. You can't ever know everything about even a subset of the universe. It used to be said by sociologists, no human mind is capable of imagining what goes on in New York City in just one weekend. Not all of it. You could never take it. Well, of course you couldn't. But you also, no human mind is capable of knowing everything that takes place in a handful of soil for 1 second. All of these things are way too open and evolving to have a final answer about them. No body of empirical knowledge is complete. Therefore, there are no absolute truths. There are only probabilities. People who are into ethics tend to get alarmed at this point. Say, well, if there are no absolute truths, what's to keep everyone from acting terribly unethically? Well, the same thing that kept them from acting that way before, because it's not practical. Ethics wasn't handed down from heaven. It was developed by human beings to get along. So there are no absolute truths, and therefore, perfection, fate, and destiny are imaginary. If you are presented with a system that is perfect, a teacher who is perfect, something that is destined or fated to happen, you know you are hearing something that is imaginary.